Welcome to the Hermitage Worship Service. This is the service for Sunday, January 3rd, the Feast of the Epiphany. I'm Reverend Kathy Howell, chaplain of the Hermitage. Let us listen to our prelude performed by Betty Cooley. What child is this? Well, Happy New Year, everyone. Welcome to our worship service today. Today we celebrate the end of the Christmas season. Officially, the Christmas season itself, Advent, is the first 4 weeks prior to December 25th, and then the first four Sundays prior to December 25th. And then the Christmas season lasts for 12 days, starting on December 25th, and running until January 6th, which is Twelfth Night. Hence the Christmas Carol, the 12 Days of Christmas. It celebrates the Epiphany, which is the of our Lord, which is the time that the wise men, we celebrate the fact that the wise men visited Jesus, the Magi. So our call to worship begins with a quote, with a reading from Isaiah chapter 60. Arise, shine, for your light has come. And the glory of the Lord has risen upon you. Nations will come to your light, kings to you the brightness of your dawn, and they shall bring gold and frankincense, and they shall proclaim the praises of the Lord. Amen. Our opening hymn will be the verses 3 through 6 of the First Noel by the Mormon Tabernacle Choir.
Thank you.
This is the time we lift up our joys and our concerns. We have some joys to celebrate. Terry Firth is back from rehab. Last week, Daniel Fincher came back. This week, Terry Firth came back, and that's a wonderful thing. John Lumstead, however, is in the hospital. So please pray for John. And actually, he's gone to rehab, so pray for him. And pray for his wife, Mary. She lives down on the G level. Also, a healthcare resident, Donald Garma, passed away this week. Let's keep his family in prayer. Of course, we have our concerns, the things that are always on our heart, to pray for everyone at the Hermitage, the residents, the employees, the loved ones and families of all those people. We pray for our protection and safety as this pandemic continues. We pray that the pandemic, of course, will be brought under control. There is fear for even a worse spike after Christmas, and that'll be about 2 weeks from now, than the spike we had after Thanksgiving, which has overwhelmed hospitals in many parts of our country. We want to pray for all of our military, including Joseph Bixler, who is deployed overseas. We want to pray for all victims of violence and war. There is so much going on. But we ask God to nurture and protect us. We pray for our nation, our nation's leaders, and we pray for all people of good heart, that they may hear God's voice and rise up and do what they are called to do. Let us pray. Lord God, we thank you for the many blessings in our lives. We thank you that we have been given the gift of a new year. Let this year unfold in a way that it'll bring restoration to so many. People have been facing financial hardships, this pandemic. There's grief, there's loss, there's fear. Lord God, there's so much need in the world. We pray that during this year, that this epidemic, the pandemic, will come to an end. We pray and thank you for all those essential workers, medical, non-medical alike, who have continued to allow our world to function, oftentimes at the risk of their own lives. We pray too for our loved ones and family. We pray for those who, for the families of all those who live here and all those who work here. We give thanks that Terry has returned from rehab. And we pray for all, for John as he begins rehab. Watch after him and support, nurture his family and loved ones, particularly his wife, Mary Lumstead. We ask you, Lord, also to comfort all those who grieve, especially the family of Donald Garmer. We pray, Lord, that you will give leaders, that inspire the leaders of all nations to work toward that which is good, to cooperate with one another, to share the wealth so that the needs of the poor and the disenfranchised are addressed. We pray for our leaders, Lord, particularly the leaders of our own nation who are in a time of transition at present. We pray, Lord, for all who are deployed overseas, for all who serve in our military, for all the police and those who have to try to use their judgment and sometimes almost an instantaneous decision. Help them to choose wisely and to be guided by your spirit and your wisdom. We ask these things as we add our own intentions in silence. Let us pray the prayer that Jesus Christ, our Savior, taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Amen. Our next hymn is Do You Hear What I Hear by Bing Crosby. We'll be singing.
Said the night wind to the little lamb. Do you see what I see?
Do you see what I see?
Way up in the sky, little lamb. Do you see what I see?
Do you see what I see?
A star, dancing in the night, with a tail as big as a kite. With a tail as big as a kite. Said the little lamb to the shepherd boy, do you hear what I hear?
Do you hear what I hear?
Ringing through the sky, shepherd boy. Do you hear what I hear?
Do you hear what I hear?
A song, high above the tree, with a voice as big as the sea. With a voice as big as the sea. Said the shepherd boy to the my king, do you know what I know? In your palace warm, mighty king, do you know what I know? A child shivers in the cold. Let us bring him silver and gold. Let us bring him silver and gold. Said the king to the people everywhere, listen to what I say. Pray for peace, people everywhere. Listen to what I say.
Our scripture reading today comes from the Gospel of Matthew. In the time of King Herod, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem. They asked, "Where is the child who was born King of the Jews? For we have observed his star at its rising and have come to pay him homage." When King Herod heard this, he was frightened, and all Jerusalem was frightened with him. He called together all the chief priests and the scribes, and he inquired where the Messiah was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it has been written by the prophet, 'And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah, for from you shall come a ruler who is to shepherd my people Israel.'" Then Herod secretly called for the wise men and inquired of them the exact time the star had appeared. He then sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go search diligently for the child, and when you found him, bring word to me so that I may also go and pay him homage." When the wise men had heard the king, they set out, and there ahead of them, the star they had seen at its rising. They followed it until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star had stopped, they were overwhelmed with joy. On entering the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they knelt down and they paid him homage. Then, opening their treasure chests, they offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they left for their own country by another road. Now after they had left, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream. "Get up, take the child and his mother, and flee to Egypt, and remain there until I tell you that Herod is it until I tell you, for Herod is about to search for the child to try and destroy him. Then Joseph got up, and he took the child and his mother by night and went to Egypt. He remained there until the death of Herod. This was to fulfill the prophecy that had been spoken by the Lord, "Out of Egypt I have called my son." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. You know, we all know the story of the wise men, the plays, how the fact that because three gifts are listed in the Bible, we figure there must be three kings. It only says plural. It doesn't tell us how many kings there were. But by medieval times, stories had risen up about them, and they had names: Gaspar, Melchior, and Balthazar. You know. And, of course, these represented, as you may have heard in previous sermons during your lifetime, how these foreign magi, these wise men from a distant land, proved the fact that Jesus came for all people and not just Jews. He'd already been revealed to the shepherds, who were the poor, who were Jewish, but they were poor and on the margins of their society. And now the richest in the world, among the richest in the lands, the wise men from the East. Well, it's a wonderful story. We also all probably know what Herod does next: the slaughter of the innocents. Every male child in Bethlehem under the age of 2 is killed. Modern statisticians say that in a village the size that Bethlehem was in those days, though it wasn't as many children as you might think, of the 40 or so babies, usually 30 to 40 babies in a town with that population under the age of 2, of course roughly half would be females. So we're talking about the slaughter of 15 to 20 children. You know, historians, skeptics want to say that just that since the historians don't talk about the slaughter of the innocents, it must not have happened. But there's enough written about Herod and the awful things he did that we don't need to know. That it isn't necessary that 12 peasant babies, 12 to 15, maybe 20 peasant babies under the age of 2 would be slaughtered is not very much when you consider the other horrendous deeds he did. He was ruthless. He was paranoid. He killed one of his wives and two of his own sons because he believed at different times, and that was over different periods of time, because he believed they were plotting against him. As a matter of fact, Caesar at the time made a joke. It makes sense in Latin. It's better to be Herod's pig, ois, instead of his son, ois, heos, with an H, O-I-S, instead of his son, H-O-I-S. Because after all, Jews don't eat pigs, and he wouldn't kill you. Terrible thing to say. But Herod was that way. He was so despised by his people, he didn't believe anybody would mourn on the day of his death. So, he called, as his death was drawing near, he had the heads of every major family in Jerusalem, actually through the entire kingdom, brought to the stadium in Jerusalem and kept under guard. Actually, in probably Caesarea, which is where he was, Caesarea Maritima. And he had them kept under guard. And he ordered that at the moment of his death, each one of the heads of all these great families of Israel would be put to death. His reasoning? Well, because he wanted all of Judah, to all of his kingdom, to wail and mourn and at the hour of his death, even if it wasn't for him. How awful is that? Well, as it turns out, it didn't happen because that was his sister went to the guards and countermanded the order and ordered everyone released at the moment of his death. Well, Jesus was spared from that atrocity, wasn't he? He was spared from being slaughtered with the baby boys of Bethlehem, those innocent children. An angel appeared to Joseph and told him to flee to Egypt. Well, such a journey would be very expensive. I want you to think about this, how well God plans things. I mean, Mary and Joseph weren't wealthy, but just by coincidence, shortly before they fled to Egypt, they were given gifts by these wise men, gifts of gold, frankincense, which is worth more than its weight in gold. It's fairly light, and it's worth more than its weight in gold. And myrrh, the same thing. Extremely costly, but small and easy to travel with. I wouldn't be surprised if those gifts are what funded Mary and Joseph's time in Egypt. And after all, another lucky, quotes, coincidence. Actually, I had a good friend, God rest her soul, named Miss Gainey, and Carol Gainey, and she used to say, a coincidence is just when God wants to be kept anonymous. What happened? Wasn't it a coincidence that Joseph was a carpenter? The actual word used in the Greek is tekton, which means someone who works with their hands in wood and stone. You see, if he'd been a farmer, he'd need land to plow. Where are you going to find land in Egypt? Maybe he could have bought some with that money, but if he wanted to keep a low profile, you know, if he was a shepherd, he'd have to have flocks. Also cumbersome, not portable. Very slowly. No. Instead, he's a carpenter. He's a man who works with his hands. He is able to make a living because his knowledge is here, in his head, and the skill of his hands, and a few basic tools, which I'll wager he brought with him everywhere he went. No. God's timing is perfect. His plan unfolds in ways we can't imagine. God had it all covered, didn't he? He had it all figured out. Nobody would have predicted it. Nobody would have seen it that way. But it's the way it was. God had provided for Mary and Joseph all that they would need. And I want to say sometimes, well, that's nice, but that God did it for his only begotten son. But the truth is, I believe he does it for us too. He gives us what we need when we need it. And I kind of find that as a surprise, but my husband and I had a nice house. We bought it with the intention that if my mother ever needed to come live with us, we expected her to be wheelchair bound, we were going to convert it. As it turned out, she didn't come live with us. We wanted her to, but circumstances unfolded that she didn't. But it turned out to be a wonderful house. It's the house we lived in while I was in seminary. I was working full-time as a nurse, and Chuck was working as a police officer and with his little heating and air conditioning business. And I also was very active in the church because I basically, because I was a seminarian, I was functioning in a sort of informal associate pastor for my local church as a almost an apprenticeship, in addition to the classes and everything I was taking in seminary. And our house was large, and it was easy to get into and open, and it hosted Bible studies and parties, and just they began to call it the church annex. And it was a wonderful place to be. And then when Chuck got sick and got cancer, we had a huge den. The den had four sets of French glass doors that ran on either side. I mean, two sets on one side with side lights. So that's four doors on here, four doors over there, four doors here, and four doors there. On one side, we had a pool. And on the other side, we had a private garden that was off the driveway and had a fence around, six privacy fence around it. And when Chuck had cancer and became bedridden, that's where we put the bed. We put Chuck's bed right there in our huge den. We set it in a way that the recliner and the TV and the sofas, they were all set in there, and there was still plenty of room. That way people could come and see him. I could open the French doors on a nice day. And the fresh air and the sunshine would almost like being outside. Of course, the house had a little wear and tear, and that's one of the things he regretted, because Chuck was such a handyman. He was always going to do it himself, and he was quite capable of doing it himself. And he said, "Kathy, the only thing, I'm sorry, I didn't get all these projects done. I know next year when you graduate from seminary, you'll have to sell the house and go wherever the bishop sends you. And I really wanted to get those things done so the house would be in shape for sale, but I just ran out of time." I said, "Don't worry, darling. You know, I can get it all done." Of course, secretly, I was feeling overwhelmed. Well, Chuck went to the Lord on a summer's day, on a day in March, which in New Orleans it was beautiful and sunny, and the French doors were open. When he breathed, I held his hand, and he breathed his last. And I remember thinking, he's absent from the body, but now he's present with the Lord. But about a year and a couple of months later, March, it was time to start thinking about selling the house. And I was worried. I consulted my friend, who actually was a real estate appraiser, and she was an active member of the church, and she was actually our church treasurer. And she came and she took a look at the house. She gave me an idea of what to ask for it, and you know, and she told me all the things that I needed to fix. Well, it wasn't but the next day that a friend called from church. He'd been part of the Bible studies that had been coming to my house when I was having them, which they'd stopped when Chuck got too sick. And our Bible studies, and you know, he'd come for over 2 years, Terry. And he says, "Kathy," he tells me on the phone, mind you, "Kathy, I want to buy your house." I said, "What?" "Yeah, well, I understand you're selling it. I've been looking for a house in Belchase." Belchase was the sort of bedroom community. It had become that during my lifetime, a bedroom community for New Orleans. It wasn't all that fancy when my parents bought there in the 50s, but by 2000, it had become high-end, and people a lot of the houses that were being built were three times as expensive as mine. Mine was a very nice house. It was a nice four-bedroom, two-bath house. Actually, it was only three bedrooms and two baths, but it had that huge den, and it had an extra huge area, the converted double garage that I'd used for an office while I was studying in seminary. And Terry says, look, this is wonderful. I have been looking for a house. My kids, I want them to stay in school in Belle Chasse, but my mother needs to come live with me. She's been living in Shreveport. And your house is perfect because it's in the price range I can afford, which is half of what I'd pay for it. For all the, because everything on the market sees luxury houses, and I just need a nice house. And he said, and plus, she's in a wheelchair. When I was in the 1950s, when I was a baby, I was given the Salk vaccine. And before my mother could get hers, she caught polio. I suppose she was one of the last people to catch polio. And she's been in a wheelchair ever since. And your house can be converted to a wheelchair. Now, I really want to buy it. I said, well, come on over and take a look. He said, I don't need to look, Kathy. I've been in that house 100 times. He said, I know it's perfect. And look, I've got to do some, I want to do some renovations in order to fix up another handicap bathroom there, and fix up everything for my mother. So don't worry about all the little things that need to be done. I know you've got that little bit of bad wood by the base of the garage door and things like that. Please don't worry about them because I'm going to do all that. I'm going to let my workers do all that because I have to do major renovations to put in the plumbing and everything for a new bathroom and to construct everything to suit my mother. But it's the perfect house, and I had just about given up. But when I heard about you selling your house, I thought, oh, this is a godsend. And he said, however, there's just one thing. What? And I said, what, Terry? And he said, well, I have to pay cash. Big problem, huh? No problem at all. And because I hadn't yet signed with an agent, we didn't have to pay a broker's fee. And you know, and he said, oh, it was an answer to my prayer. And I said, well, Terry, it's an answer to my prayer, too. God answered two prayers. Well, then God answered two prayers with one stroke. What a coincidence. And I said, what would Carol Ganey say? He laughed, and he said, because Carol Ganey had been in the same Bible study with Terry. And she said, no, he'd say, it's just God being anonymous. It happens still today. Just as God provided for Mary and Joseph the things they would need to survive in Egypt. Joseph with his ability to earn a living in his hands and his head and a few simple tools, extra money for the journey in the form of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Those are just the times we see God's tapestry woven together, see glimpses of pieces that fit. But we don't get to see the whole picture. Not now. But that day will come, my friends. I am convinced. We just have to trust in God, trust in Jesus Christ, and know that the day will come when we go to the place that Jesus has prepared for us. Amen. This is the first Sunday of the new year, and in place of our regular creed, I would like to use a prayer of the covenant service. It is a covenant service that was written by John Wesley, the founder of Methodism, but it's a way to focus and reconnect with God and make it once more on the first of the year. Actually, in Wesley's day, in the early 1700s, he would gather people in the churches at midnight to celebrate this covenant service instead of having them out on the streets reveling and drinking and getting into trouble. Let us pray. Brothers and sisters in Christ, the Christian life is redeemed from sin and consecrated to God. Through baptism, we have entered this life and have been admitted to the new covenant, of which Jesus Christ is the mediator. He sealed this covenant in his own blood that it might last forever. On the one side, God promises to give us new life in Christ, who is the source and the perfecter of our faith. On the other side, we are pledged to live no more for ourselves, but only for Jesus Christ, who loved us and gave himself for us. From time to time, we renew our covenant with God, especially when we reaffirm the baptismal covenant and gather at the Lord's table. As we meet today, as the generations before us have met, let us renew the covenant that binds us to God, and let us make this covenant of God our own. Together, I am no longer my own, but yours. Put me to what you will, rank me with whom you will. Put me to doing, put me to suffering. Let me be employed for you or laid aside for you, exalted for you or brought low for you. Let me be full, let me be empty. Let me have all things, let me have nothing. I freely and wholeheartedly yield all things to you, O Lord. And now, the glorious and blessed God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, you are mine, and I am yours, so be it. And the covenant now made on earth, let it be ratified in heaven. Amen. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. In the coming year, may you find God's blessing in your life. May you see glimpses of the way he has woven things around you in a that are coincidences, yet are designed to meet your needs in every way. May you trust in him and feel his love each and every step of your journey through life until the day we join him in glory. In the name of the Father and of the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen.